cool. So probably half of you are here because you know me, and probably half of you are here, because you don't know what land-based living is, right? It's intriguing. So first of all, let me talk about who I am. I'm Matt Powers. I'm a family guy, and I'm from the East Coast. I'm gonna keep walking in front of that, just beware. I'm from the East Coast. I grew up in New England where it's cold, and then I moved out here. Lost a lot of weight when I moved out here. I think my body like noticed the climate change. And I became a, alright, so the reason we came out here, my wife's right there. My wife got cancer about 9 years ago. She got thyroid cancer. And I was a musician, and I wasn't really using my full brain at this point in my life. I was in my early 20s. I basically had made it. I was playing with all professional musicians in New York City, traveling all over the US, and I really didn't think that hard about things. People picked me up, they always paid for dinner. It was a very easy life. And my wife got cancer, and it changed all of that, like, really fast. And I became a teacher because I wanted to be home so that I could serve my wife and my kids better. And then I wanted to, I wanted to make sure that the food was clean, because as any of you know, when you start getting into what organic actually means, it's like a rabbit hole, and then the more you learn about it, the more you want to just grow it yourself and have a garden at home. And so I started doing that, and I really got hooked. And I started falling in love with nature. And in a way that I think as a kid I always loved nature on a deep level, but I never bridged that into my intellectual academic person or self. And actually until very recently I wasn't able to bridge that gap between myself as a person emotionally and meaning-wise with science. And actually in the past year, the stuff I've been able to research and learn in permaculture, like specifically with Dr. Lane Ingham, has really liberated me from the definition that high school gave me about what my relationship is to science and my ability in science. Changed my life in a lot of ways, because we all have access to what science is. And we all can check these things and prove them to ourselves. And it all came from my garden. It all started in this beautiful place right outside Yosemite, right above Fresno. It's beautiful in winter, and it's beautiful where I've created my site. But I just fell in love with food, and this is all from my garden. All the pictures you see here are, unless they're labeled, and I'll tell you that they aren't mine. All the pictures are mine. This is a dry farming patch. So that is seed I planted in early spring, and the rains fed it. It's still green and setting seed today. 2 weeks ago, I checked my amaranth in this dry patch, hasn't been watered in months, and it had a seed head like this, and I was like, oh wow, it's actually going to set seed, and it's been just forever, right? I walked away from it this week, and it was this big, a seed head this big on a plant that tall. And it's like, where did you get the energy to do this? And so all this is connected. I was a school teacher, and I wrote this curriculum called The Permaculture Student, and it really took all that stuff that people are talking about on the internet, all this permaculture books, all this stuff, and made it so that eighth graders could do it on their own. So I'm a homeschool parent and a public school teacher. In my area, almost all the teachers are homeschool parents too. What does that say about the schools? So I wrote this curriculum, and it really like pulled me out of my little town up in the foothills of the Sierra Nevadas, and pulled me into a broader stage. And so I was this musician, and then I was serving people with my music, sort of, more like myself, right? And then I started serving people as a teacher, and really got into that, and permaculture was like the solution. This is like the first time I could say something that was actually correct, scientifically, mathematically, all this stuff, and it wasn't politically charged. For me, it was like, it was the ultimate solution to dealing with all the stuff that happens in high school with sophomores. Because you've got to lead them through that developmental stage properly. That sophomore year is a critical year. And I taught that was my year when I was in school. When I was a teacher in school. So literally, I made basically my annual pay in a month with Kickstarter with this book. And they were at the same time at the school, like putting extra pressure on me and all this stuff because they had switched bosses. You know how new bosses always have to exert some authority to feel like they're doing something? So they just focused on me because they didn't understand my program. And so I just was like, I'm going to follow this because it's much nicer and people are wanting me and asking me to do it and you're fighting me. And so I just did that, and that's what I've been doing, and that's really who I am. Now, let's talk about land races. Do we know what land races are? Raise your hand if you know what land races are. Okay, all right, some people know what land races are. They're pretty incredible. We know what heirlooms are, right? We know what heirloom seeds are? Okay, good. So this is a land race from Peru. It's one of those Peruvian corns that Rare Seeds Baker Creek sells. It's one of the ones that Joseph and Patrick Simcox got from Peru. I can't find anyone else other than Stephen Smith, the corn guy. I figured out with permaculture how to grow it in the Central Valley. And these are years from my farm. And I can't find anyone else other than Stephen Smith who been growing corn since he's 12. And I'll tell you how he did this in a second. So it's really beautiful. I wish I could make it bigger. They look like little galaxies. It's speckled. I'm all into speckles right now. If it's got speckles on it, I love it. And stripes, I love it. This is another land race. This is Painted Mountain Flower Corn. Do you guys know Painted Mountain Flower Corn? It's an 89-day corn. And so it's super fast. It's not as fast as some that Stephen has. Stephen has a 49-day corn. I don't know. He's getting stuff from amazing places. So these are also represent in a lot of ways a land race. These are Brad Gates' Wild Boar Farms next door. You know those crazy tomatoes? He bred land races basically by crossing wild varieties with tame varieties, and he created these huge genetic like storms. And then he picks out of them and be like, yes, I pick you. And then solidify that line and stabilize that line, the genetic line. And then that is his new heirloom. It's out of these storms of genetic material that we get all of our heirlooms. So before heirlooms, we have these things called land races. These are all my seed pictures and all my for food pictures. I love taking pictures of food and seed. So all purity came from genetic diversity. And I know we always talk about how much diversity there is, and but there's a place from which it comes. We get this unique diversity out of embodying diversity. So all diversity is created through adaptation to the environmental conditions and breeding techniques over time. So the local area and the person breeding it are going to affect that. So there's a phenotypic response that develops over time to that specific area. So the land races are really, if you go look at a land race in India of chickpeas, and I know Jared is actually heading out there at some point to India to do this. I'm excited about getting some new chickpeas, aren't you guys? In the catalog this next year. And you go to these land races and they're a rainbow. And you're like, oh, which variety is that? And they're like, it's the variety. And there's like 12 colors and like 4 different sizes and, you know, all this variety. And it's, what happens is, oh, it's a wet year. Oh, those green ones did great this year. Oh, it's a super dry year. Those brown and black ones, they did the best this year. And meanwhile, your library of genetics is huge and you always can adapt. And so it's a really powerful thing to grow land races. Most people don't realize you can build land races by that's what Painted the Glass Gem Corn is. He made that, and that's what Painted Mountain Corn is too. They combine the genetics of select species to create this big genetic monster, you know, of combined genes. And I don't know if you guys have heard about Carl Barnes' seed, the Glass Gem Corn, but it's so diverse that you don't need to grow 150 to 200 seeds like in a field to make sure they all pollinate so inbreeding doesn't happen. The seeds are diverse enough already to support you taking like 3 of those, then growing out and taking those seeds and continuing, and it won't shrink. So we think about, I mean, we all know about genetic inbreeding with corn, right? You can't grow, if you grow and save from a small amount, it starts shrinking the corn. That's why the big corn fields work so well. Anyway, so we need to save, breed, and share our seeds. I'm sorry. And so that brings us to permaculture. And this is kind of the living part where it branches. So do you guys know that permanent culture started off as permanent agriculture? Hey, Sarah. And then it became permaculture. It started off as permanent agriculture, then it became permaculture. And so permaculture now, and this is my definition, is a holistic design science based on the systems and patterns of nature that serves both the people and the planet regeneratively and ethically. The way I talk about kids to it though, about it though, is it's seeing the world through the lens of nature, through nature's eyes, and doing what's best for nature and people, and cares for the future. And when you put it that way, you're like, oh, well, we got to think about the future of nature and the future of people. It puts it into this, like, triangulation that allows for, like, complete understanding between peoples of multiple ages. And then it's like, oh, well, we can't do that because that'll mess that up. We can't do that because people, you know, we need to develop a better community. And I feel like that's what we've lost in a lot of our communities, is this idea that we can create better cultures constantly. So permaculture is based on these 3 ethics, earth care, human care, and originally it was called return of surplus, but I'm really liking care of the future better lately because it makes more sense and it actually communicates faster and clearer what works. Because return of surplus sounds very economic. And so that return of surplus could be defined as like compost or leaving your leaves, you know, on the lawn instead of breaking them up and burning them awful like that. You know, and then, you know, human care, the overlap in the middle between all these things is permaculture. When we're achieving all these different things, when we're saving for the future, when we're reinvesting in the landscape, those kinds of things. So it may look like a fantasy, right? This is a picture from my book. It may look like a fantasy, but the reality is it's really happening. And this is a World Bank project. I know the World Bank has, the dirty laundry list, let's say. Chomsky's a pen pal of mine, so believe me, I'm there. But this is one of their projects. They took a 10,000-year-old problem and fixed it in 6 years with permaculture, perennial planting, earthworks that trap rain, and not cutting the ground any longer, no tillage, right? So what they did, and you can see here that they started doing terraces on the left, it was a desert land. Much worse than the Central Valley. It's the size of Belgium we're talking about. So Central Valley could easily be compared to this. So we talk about how bad the Central Valley is, right? It is now a verdant paradise in comparison. And has anyone here studied Chinese history? Anyone? Okay, so you know above that mountain range, in northern China, what happens is they do not develop an island that goes in to their eye. It stays flat. Why? It protects them from the loose silt that is carried in the air. If I went and lived in certain areas of China while this loose silt was in the air, I'd eventually go blind because it gets caught in the seam of my eye and just gets flowing into my eye constantly and is an irritant, messes up your sight. So it was a 10,000-year-old problem that they actually adapted to. This was where agriculture began in China. The Han Dynasty, the Han family, is from here. They're the dominant minority group, or majority group, really, of China. So this problem is 10,000 years old. It was caused by agriculture. And then they applied carbon farming, or perennial farming, or perennial culture, or permaculture, whatever you want to call it. And in 6 years, the people are earning more money than they ever could have imagined. They're saving money. They're wearing jackets and coats and dressing nicely as they work in their field plots in this. Why? Because they have so much self-respect for themselves. And they're so excited and have so much hope. Because they... And imagine what this would do to the children of the areas that are devastated in America right now. If we could take it from desert to paradise in 6 years, in their childhood, and have them do it too. So those are the kind of things that inspire me, that that this is the Los Plateau Project. You can actually go into Google Earth, fly over this, just type in the Los Plateau, and you can fly over this, and you go on for hundreds and hundreds of miles in all directions, and you can just see it. It's absolutely incredible. And it's something anyone here can design and then organize and run an operation like this. Because as you'll see, it is not rocket science, it is something that is a birthright that all of us understand intrinsically when we hear it. And that's what's so powerful about permaculture. It's not techniques, it's a way of seeing the world that is taking care of us and taking care of nature, and that's natural. That shouldn't be a natural thing, and the fact is we've been educated with missing pieces in our education, and we just get those pieces, it suddenly clicks, and we're like, oh, so I can be the most powerful force for good in my local ecology? I've been told the exact opposite my whole life. And when you give that to children, when they see the results, and when they see when they see that they can be the change in their own lives, in their own areas, in their own families, there's a change that's unstoppable. So this is a Google Maps. You can just see it. It looks like this. Those are all flat areas. So we talk about all these different things: desertification, soil loss, water scarcity, deforestation, food scarcity, nutritional deficiency, habitat loss, mass extinction. But it really comes down to a change in our climates. And if we want to talk about climate change, it's really simple. Really, really simple. We remove the primeval forest from the earth, and then all the agriculture areas we've been tilling, releasing all the carbon in the soil, and we've been salting those areas with all the pesticides and biocides and fertilizers. They're all salts. So we've been cutting the earth with those salts, releasing that organic matter and carbon. And so we literally, all that carbon and all those things that, you know, kept the sun off the earth, trapped water, allowed it to develop in the soil, all those things are missing from our environment. So let's say we go out here, we chop all the trees down and remove all, and just start tilling the ground. Well, unless you water it, it's not going to be covered, and we don't have to water a lot of these landscapes for them to stay green over the summers and evenings. So we can create climate change in our local area and see that it's real. We all know it. You can make a desert by just removing all the trees and the plants. But when we do it on a worldwide scale, it's really hard to track. And then when we get into this whole esoteric talk about like CO2, without realizing that, you know, I'm exhaling CO2 at the top, and CO2 is what plants take in. And then that, right, we have to talk about the whole cycle and actually talk about where the linchpins in the cycle were, the trees and the plants and the soil, right? So, I want to talk more about that, but we'll keep going. I have a few slides here. But we can talk more about carbon at the end, because there's a lot of interesting things about carbon that people just all know. Okay, so initially permaculture was really kind of, it was self-oriented, it was young. Like when we're teenagers, we're thinking about ourselves. So like, I want my own self-sufficient farm, and I want to do this, and da-da-da. But since then, since the 25 years since it began, Bill Mollison's work has germinated. And it's become this whole other thing that I'm now kind of going and trying to wrap my arms around and make a high school textbook out of. And I'll just run through some of these. The rise of holistic management and design. So, you know, J.C. Smuts created holism, that idea of holism, like 100 years ago. But Alan Savory applied it to cattle grazing in Africa in such a way that he realized that there's such a thing as brittle climates and non-brittle climates. This is probably his most enduring realization, plus his whole holistic management design. Basically, you guys, brittle climates, you cut the ground and it doesn't heal. And if it's really brittle, it spreads. That's called desertification, or desiccation theory if you want to go to ecology. The other side of it is non-brittle climates, you cut it and it heals like in a couple weeks or days. That's like Missouri. You guys ever go out to Missouri and visit the Baker Creek there? So it's how we manage animals on these different land types that causes the different reaction. The same thing with the way we do agriculture. We're applying European agriculture to the tropics, and we're tilling the soil away, and wash the white, right? Same thing. It's misapplied technique, and that's why we have to get past technique and just start talking about what nature is doing and how nature reasons, really. A revolution in soil science with Dr. Elaine Ingham. Elaine is amazing. She's taught me so much, and she was the person that created the methodology that allowed us to realize that the food soil web wasn't like 200,000, it's millions and billions, and we don't know what's going on. She was the one who basically proved that nematodes, you know, aren't all root feeders. She's the one that, you know, she's the basically the compost queen when we get down to it. So she's been like tutoring me the past year and giving me so much insight and all this stuff. And she created methodology that could have been created 100 years ago. But because they were dissatisfied and just sitting on their heels for this long that they didn't do anything, she showed up and she was like, well, how do you prove that? How do you know? And just to give you an example, and this may relieve some of you, maybe irritate some of you, but high school, remember biology, the moles, even out the moles, that whole thing, most of that isn't even real. It doesn't actually happen in the soil. Most of it's mathematically possible. It's not actually possible in the soil, so why are we doing it? Kind of gut-wrenching when you think about it. That was hard for me. And to make me feel I was dumb and didn't get nature because I couldn't balance moles, right? And a lot of kids feel that way. They're like, oh, I'm not good at balancing moles, or I'm not remembering this stuff that's completely out of context. Elaine brings it into context, soil life into context. And so I've been taking her college level stuff and bringing down to middle school, elementary school, and making new curriculum. So there's been a paradigm shift in genetics in this time period as well. Epigenetics proves that on the sides of all of our genes are these switches. So each bundle, each line, each code line of our genes is not a phenotypic expression. It's actually a library of phenotypic expression. And the switches, our behavior and perception, affects it. So if I suddenly decide that I'm depressed and I go into this whole depression, I can affect my body. We all know this, right? I can cause myself to get sick and die. This happens with people when their spouses sometimes die. We have this is a long history of this, you know, happening. People's body can shut down if they emotionally are feeling that way. So our perception. Also, if I just start, you know, treating my body horribly and start doing things that, you know, are very unhealthy, I'll start getting cancers or other things that start happening. And that's actually a genetic response. It's an epigenetic response. Viruses, the reaction we get from viruses are actually sticking themselves in between our encoding genes and causing these mistakes and these symptoms we're having are that. I don't know why I was never told this in school, that our genes are constantly combining and we're not fixed in place. But that's how genes were presented to me, or at least that's how I understood them at the time. So, genetics and, check out Epigenetics. 2005, the cover of Discover magazine was DNA is not destiny. Amazing stuff. The emergence of mycology as a core science. Did you guys know that fungi was the first eukaryotes on this planet? First eukaryotes, before plants, before animals. Do you know that plants are all part fungi, and we're all part fungi? Pretty basic, and kind of weird that we don't know this, and it's not like the plant kingdom is like fungi, and then everything comes off of it, right? Very, very interesting stuff. Mycology is called a neglected megascience. And rightly so, it's absolutely incredible. So, Radical Mycology is a book I'm reading right now, and it's, here's a tidbit. Lichen fixed nitrogen in the cold temperate climate. So when we talk about, oh, why are there not many nitrogen fixing trees in the cold temperate climate? Oh, because lichen is doing that. And lichen is half fungi, half algae. They're mutualists. Yeah, okay, so you get it. There's crazy amounts of more things I could discuss, but the mycology edge of it is a brand new branch of science that's coming forward really, really fast, and it's so incredible. For instance, Basidiomycota, they're the ones that produce mushrooms primarily. they form a dikaryotic state where they are balancing multiple, they have multiple nuclei, they have two nuclei. And then glomerulomycota collects nuclei. And no one knows which nuclei is in charge. In fact, it looks like someone else is in charge and picking and choosing which nuclei's information to use, which throws our whole classification system out the window, by the way, because which species is it? It just took that species, that species, that species' nuclei, and now we don't know because it's expressing three of them. Crazy, right? Okay, so I won't go any more into that, but it's very, very, very rich, 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 fertile earth to go and plant some seeds in. Oh wait, there's more things that happen. So the so permaculture turned into this humanitarian aid effort in a lot of ways. Stuart Muir Wilson, Bill Mollison's grandson, he works in Australia to raise money to go to Mexico and build alternative permaculture architecture, so sustainable homes, and he gives them away to the people who don't have homes there. And that's what he spends his life doing. And that's his third ethic, and he talks about it all the time. That's his giving back to the future. Amazing stuff. Okay, so there's all been all this, and I'll get into this later in the talk. There's been this rediscovery of how we generated energy, how we stored energy, how we worked with a lot of water catchment, and we'll get into it. It's really, really awesome. Carbon sequestration and carbon farming, we'll talk about that. And then urban farming has been facilitated, really, the boom, the fact that Curtis Stone can like make 100 grand on like a third of an acre in, you know, up in Canada. The reason he can do that is because we have the technology now that he can figure out exactly how to do things. And he can track things exactly and then set up metrics. And because of that, he's figured out some very interesting things. You can crop rotate in season. You can do plantings every 4 weeks. You can only till the top inch with a harrow. There's all this fancy stuff that is allowing us to do annuals, allowing us to do biointensive without destroying hyphae of the mushroom, the mycelium beneath the surface. So, yes, we can move on now. So, individual to generational, what's happened? We've gone from it's about me, get me off the grid, to like let's get everyone off the grid. Let's solve the big problem is not that I need to go off grid and have a fortress and have my food storage and all my guns or whatever, right? It's let's get our community to a place where our children grow up proud, resilient, interdependent, and happy. I mean, schools are racked with depression. The teachers are depressed, stressed, and freaked out. The kids in third grade are like, I don't know what college I'm gonna go to. It's true. They're worried about it. And so we need to get to a place where we create fertile soils in our hearts and in the land around us. So it needs to go from agriculture being fixed to all culture being fixed. Because that's really where we're at, right? I can't accept that my family's okay and your family's not. How am I going to sleep at night? I can't deal with that. So we've gone, and we can see this happening, we've gone from the agrarian to the industrial to the information, and now we have to move past that into the regenerative. We need to be restorative. We need to be people who create. And if we look back at all the religions of all the humans from all the cultures of the world, what do we worship? Creation. Let's embrace that. Whatever we feel, whatever we believe, let's embrace that. Creation. We are the creators, not destroyers. And if we embrace that definition, I believe that everyone, no matter their skill or talents, will find a place in the ecosystems that we develop in our societies. I believe it's a new renaissance. I believe it is the way forward for all of us to find place. So it's not just like, oh, we're going to take care of each other. I don't like them. No, it's what works for everyone, for our local community. What are the solutions? Because there are solutions. And that's the thing that we've been taught in schools that drives me nuts, and the politics teaches us it's not zero-sum games we're playing in this life. We're mutualists. So local food, CSAs, this has been the hottest thing of the past 20 years for real food. And people are worried about this in the food industry because these people are taking away their equity fast. Community gardens, edible landscapes. This is something taken out. This is the Beacon Food Forest up in Seattle. I have a friend who went here on, they go there on dates now. And it's like, oh man, we've come so far. It's like, yeah, right? It's not like we're gonna go to coffee or Starbucks and then see the other Starbucks while we're sitting at this Starbucks. No, we're gonna go and embrace nature. And it's gonna be this growth, this progression out of this place we're in. So people are taking responsibility, taking action all over the country. And this renaissance is happening regardless of what the media is gonna say and do. And if you've noticed, Huffington Post is grudgingly printing all of our stuff now. Suburban farms are spreading like crazy. I mentioned Curtis Stone. He's using other people's lawns to do his farm and giving them produce in return as the rent. And then making like 70 to 100 grand on only 6 acres of land spread out among all these. No, actually, no, it's not 6 acres, it's a third of an acre, it's 6 plots. Yeah, it's crazy, but it's totally possible. And think about all the college kids who don't have work right now. Oh, well, how about you go around the neighborhood? I'll give you some seeds, Bobby. And you go around and ask everybody if you could plant a garden in their front yard, okay? Yeah. Everyone's like, yeah, I need a garden, I don't have time. And all you say is like, oh, I'll grow a garden for you. I just need to take 2 of the rows out of the 4. Yeah, okay, do it. And meanwhile, that's a business that didn't exist. Those are plants that didn't exist. And how much cost did that take? Oh, it took a little time. Maybe you bought a shovel. Shovels are everywhere, right? People over there probably have one. Have a shovel somewhere. So literally with the cost of seeds and a little bit of labor, someone can have a business overnight. This is Will Allen. This is another, like I was talking about how urban farming has taken off. It's like 10,000 pounds of food in the middle of winter, quarter of an acre in Milwaukee. It's cold. Milwaukee's like real cold. Alright, because it has that water in the middle, and so it has all that like extra cold, Arctic content, water, and you're done. Yeah, I don't want to live there. So think vertical. I'm from New England, that was cold enough. So this guy is in the Bronx, and he is another school teacher. He's a fellow school teacher. He stayed in. I left. I went rogue, and he is showing kids how on their balconies in their apartments they can grow food in the middle of New York City in food deserts. This just shows you. I mean, we really could be using the edges of all the cities. We're not, because we're like, oh, that's unsightly. Oh, you can't do that because code says that will eventually tear it off. Meanwhile, there's evidence, you know, that some of these things actually make it more stable. Water catchment by design. So, does anyone know Brad Lancaster? Nice. Very consistent, I like that. So Brad Lancaster is, he's down in Tucson, and he figured out that Tucson and Phoenix, they get enough water. They get enough water. What does that mean? If they get enough water, everyone gets enough water. So it's about what we do with the water and our water budgets and how we capture water, soak, and spread it. And so he's got a great book on all this. And he finished his permaculture design course, and then he went to Africa and studied with farmers in Africa who were subsistence farming on just rainwater, and meanwhile everyone around them is in desert. So people were actually doing it is what he learned, and it's a superb book. If you want metrics, if you like numbers, yeah.
What's his name?
Brad Lancaster. It's harvestingrainwater.com. All right, so aquaculture. This is Will again. Part of his whole equation is he's having fish that are feeding off the greens, like the aquaculture system in Finley Hall. Just like that, he's doing that on a huge level. He's doing it in shelves. Something that just shows you what can be done. You know, grass carp can feed on plants in the edges, or you can just grow it and then separate that, cut it, and give it to them, right? And then the manure is fed on by other carp. And so you can create this chain of life very easily, and you can grow a lot of food. Passive energy, and you know, almost all ecosystems are this, right? There's no like, oh no, now we have waste. There's no waste in nature. We made that word up. We invented trash. So, yeah, it's just all minerals and molecules and, you know, nutrients and those things. And we're just making them moribund or, you know, anaerobic and doing these things to them that are making them into polymers or, you know what I mean? Making them so they don't cycle properly, you know. But we can fix that a lot with mycology, actually. So, passive energy. You guys know this? If you just have a hot room, a sunny room, it just heats up and the heat rises, sucking the cold air out of the other room. Yes. And you can create passive heat, and if you've been on YouTube, people are doing this in colder areas. People are doing this with greenhouses attached to homes. You just gotta make sure there's a moisture barrier, right? You want traveling in your home, rotting it. Understanding the sun, this is all part of permaculture. These are actually all part of pictures from my books. This shows you really, really well what passive energy can do. So we're in Seattle, and it's raining like crazy. And we're always just having this roof rainwater tank that's constantly filling. And maybe everyone's, all the sides of the building capture water and funnel it in as it hits it, maybe. And all that falling water, there's two things about it. Think about all the gravity. It's a constant gravitational pull down on that water, so it could turn a turbine, run LED lights, right? Right? You could also have the air that's trapped in it compress. Because if you go down and then you go sideways and then release, but if you put a little bulge there, it fills up with compressed air. It's called a trunk. I've got something like that in here. Yeah, there we go. Speaking of. So Ragged Chutes was in operation for over 70 years. It only had to be repaired twice. It had no real moving parts. It does have that lift. That lift allowed them to stop the water so they could go down and repair it, which is understandable. We forgive them for making one moving part. But as you know, if you have friends who are engineers, no moving parts and generating energy is ultimate. Okay? It's awesome. And basically what's happening here is, like I said, water's going down an 80 to 100 foot mine shaft. This is a cobalt mine in Ontario, Canada. And the air that is captured as it falls, it settles out at the bottom now. And it then becomes compressed air. Compressed air is cold too. So you can use it for refrigeration and also to run engines. But you don't necessarily want to turn it into, electricity, because that lowers your efficiency rate, right? So, you guys remember 1984, how everything's pneumonic, or pneumatic, I should say, pneumatic? It's all air pressure, right? This is the beginning of all the pneumatic stuff again. Because if we set this up anywhere there's falling water, and by the way, in cities, there's so much falling water. Let's just take all the sewers in this area and just put them together and then have it fall. Or all the storm drains. Strain it off, make sure there's nothing in there first. But I don't even know if you really need to worry about stuff being in it at this point. But you guys see, you just connect those and you have it drop 80 feet into the city. Oh, in New York City, there's 10, you guys know it's 10 stories below the sidewalk in some place in New York City? Yeah. Yep. And below Chinatown, it goes really, really deep in that area too. And actually connects to the subway stations. When I lived there, we always had like dreams of like going down there and exploring. But you know, that's dangerous. So don't do that. So yeah, Ragged Chutes, this is real. And some insurance company got it blown up and put out of commission in, I think, the 90s. And everyone in town is so sad still over it. And they're like all engineers, all these Canadian engineers, so they're super polite, and so you call them up and they just want to talk forever about it. I'm almost going to go film what's left of it up in Ontario. I don't know. I'm going to talk later this month, the engineer that's currently working here. So they turned it into a hydro plant because they sell the moving water, right? So it's a great hydro plant. It's an award-winning hydro plant. It's not as good as a Trump. So there's actually one other Trump. It's not generating electricity, but it is in St. Petersburg at Peterhof, I think. Peterhof. It's Peterhof. Yeah, the summer mansion. Who said that? You're awesome. Yeah, she knows. All right, all the fountains, and you can go and watch a video. They're all automated. They're these dancing fountains of water, and it's all very, very, very fancy and nice. It's run off of Trump. And it's from the 1600s. It's crazy. So this technology is old. This technology is tested and true. We can do it everywhere. Detroit, if you guys know about Detroit, you know that it already has the hydrology in place, and it has these, has all the infrastructure to just adapt and build this. All right. So Wallapini, speaking of another passive energy, we don't really need to worry about this here because it's so hot. But they're growing bananas 6,000 feet up in the Andes with this. And so what it does is it captures the most energy on winter solstice, on the coldest day of the year, the darkest day of the year, at least sunlight. And it's because it's 90 degree angles to that. It's at that aspect. And so it's off aspect for the rest of the year. So it's like a glancing glow, you know, with the sun, it's not direct. It makes a big, big difference. It's a Wallapini. It's a W-A-L-I-P-I-N-I. It means warm place. Okay, so you guys know that all of our paper waste is still made of trees. So it, what eats trees? Mushrooms and fungi, right? You know, it's being consumed by what the forest would consume it as. So all of our paper waste, why are we throwing in the trash? Oh, I went too far. Why are we throwing in the trash? Because all of it can be just turned into mushrooms. And I'm not saying eat those mushrooms unless it's clean, good paper. But I'm saying we don't need to throw it in the trash because it can turn into mushrooms and then that can turn into soil at home. And if we put it into the landfill, that is just going to screw up that whole cycle. With you, it just goes shoot right back into the soil. And you're like, yeah. Fix that, you know?
What about the ink on
the paper? The ink is primary soy-based ink now, so it gets eaten up.
GMO source?
Of course, but it gets eaten up. And then you have to go with the whole thing about how can it translate into any genes, because it's all been broken down into the simplest part of an ink at that point. It's carbon.
Worms love paper too.
That's because you're stealing my side. All right, I'll get there. It's later on. But we'll get there because that's what you do after. She's absolutely right. After you have your worms eat it and you have your mushroom flushes, that's when you run it through the worms because it's digestible to them. They can't eat this kind of worm. Okay, so cigarette filters. My friend Peter McCoy, he figured it out that oyster mushrooms will grow and consume cigarette filters. And then he trained them to consume used cigarette filters. So think about that. We can clean up the cities in a major way with mushrooms. So holistically speaking, we need to bring back this whole vibe, right? And we all remember that like feeling of like, yeah, it's our neighborhood. That's my neighbor. Hi, neighbor. And they're like, oh yeah, we're neighbors. Of course, it's cool. Hi. And nowadays, it's kind of opposite. Everyone's like, and then there's the neighbors. Where are my car? Doctor, don't marry. I got doctor. Okay. You know, and it's become like totally 180 as a society. And it really starts with us reaching out and showing that we're not scary and realizing they're not scary. Not to say anyone here is scary. I just say we have to model these things for everyone else, realistically. And we have to do it loudly and proudly so that they notice. So the local market, the local butcher, the local baker, the local keepery, right? We need to stop this commuting nonsense. We need you locally. It's like I was traveling all over the U.S. spreading my energy out, and my family needed me locally. But it's more than that. It's not just me locally. My like community needs me locally, you know? And all of our communities need us there checking in. We need to be there checking in, letting people know, hey, I'm here, I'm part of our community. You can rely on me being here as part of the system. So, and we need to leave, this is a holistic management concept. We need to live as things will be, not as things are. People are like, but there's still oil left. Oh, but we have solar panels. And it's like, well, those are made out of oil. 60 grams of oil per gram of solar panel. Okay? So, you know what I mean? It's like, we're not quite there. We need to get further, like the Trump. Because the Trump, I mean, we're already to the point where it's like, okay, well, the efficiency is doubled. That's good. We're saving there. And then there's no moving parts, and then it's like, let's not even do electricity. And then, you know, where you design homes, has anyone read In Praise of Light and Shadow, or In Praise of Shadows? It's a book about white and black and shadow and light, and it's about, it's also Asian philosophy, about how they view architecture and deal with the idea of opposites. And it really affects their architecture and the way they philosophize about it. Well worth a read. So, looking forward to the future. We need to buy what lasts. And that's so hard to find. I know, it's hard to find. It's almost like you gotta go to other states sometimes to find that thing that will actually last. Like a broom at the Missouri Spring Planting Festival. 20 years, it'll last 20 years, that broom. And then buy generationally. Do you guys know that the iron Edison, the nickel iron batteries, the Edison nickel iron batteries, they last generationally. They're batteries that get better with time. There's still Edison batteries that are still working. It's like, there's still Edison light bulbs that are still running. Did you guys know that? We got some of these newfangled light bulbs that last 3 days. And there's no recourse. You go in, it's last 3 days. Yeah, right.
Take them to the hazmat.
Yeah, you gotta take them to the hazmat because they're full of stuff that we, you know, sad things. Mercury. Okay, so seed balls, guerrilla gardening. This is the whole thing, taking back responsibility. We're gonna be making seed balls tomorrow morning with the kids. Feel free to come on over and help out. All these edges, the curbside, the abandoned lot, that's our land. That's our community's land. That area that's a blight, throw some seed balls on it. Cover that earth. The people that are inheriting it or buying it later on, well, thank you. Don't put, you know, crazy weeds there. But beautiful wildflowers or food. Okay. You don't want to be problems for the poor people. Here we go. So notice the curve. This is Ron Finley in LA. He basically forced LA's hand into accepting street gardens and curbside gardens. Why? Because community said, no, you can't rip that up. That's us. That's our community. That's our family. That's us. That's who we are. If we as a country, as communities individually, stand up and say, no, we don't want that produce. We have local produce. This is who we are. That will change everything. Local industry leads to local self-reliance, which is what independence is called. Independence leads to freedom. This country is founded on us being so independent that we're like, we don't need you, Britain. Goodbye. And then we had to, you know, forcefully push away from that embrace. But, you know, I mean, that's where it's all founded. And that's where we actually get power in our communities, when we actually can help each other because we're so self-reliant and interdependent. And the things that we grow are abundant. So vermicompost, as we were talking, Eric Olson over at Storyscapes, that's his hands from his backyard. He does these vermicompost swales. So he decides, you this year, and he takes all the mulch from land and puts it on there and inoculates the worms, and that's his compost pot. And he just turns rows into compost pots. It's very smart, because then you don't have to walk all the way to the compost pot, because it's right here in the garden. You just shovel to the left and right. Yeah, it's very neat. So, I love worms. I love pictures up close of nature. You can really see the soil structure forming here. So, fermentation. An unlikely edge, but really important that we preserve our food, right? We need to think seed to table, and then beyond. So, there's Tobiko's, we have water keeper over there from the Keefery. I'm a huge fan of this kind of stuff. So, other forms of preservation. Oh, I can do it. All right, so do you guys know how fermentation started? Do you know how bread started? You have bread's fungus?
It's just bacterial fungus in the air.
Yes, it's wild yeasts in the air. And so that's what the first sourdough was. Someone left their porridge out and it got bubbly and said, I don't want to eat that. It's weird. And I said, fine, I'll cook it and then you'll eat it. And they cooked it and it rose. And that was bread. And it was fungal food. And the same thing with alcohol. It's like the grape juice got left out. It's funny tasting, but I like it. And so, you know, right? And then suddenly you have alcohol, right? And it actually was a way of making sure our food was clean. And actually, I was talking to some earlier today about the fact that before the fire and the pot came to Latin America, almost everything was fermented. And that was their form of making it more digestible, instead of like cooking it, you know? Like, oh, Michael Pollan said, cooked! It's how our brains got big. Yes, we cooked it. No, it actually probably was we let our food kind of rot, and then we ate it, and then we were like, whoa, this one's the good one to eat rotten. Come here, you know? And we realized that fermented food made it way easier on our guts to digest, and made it so that it cured us of parasites. It did all this stuff. Because, I mean, we all know that when I talk about alcohol, I mean, they didn't have sealing beverages, right? So you can't go very far into alcohol land without sealing beverages. I mean, we do sealing beverages with sulfites to freeze it so it doesn't turn into vinegar. So, like, the whole alcohol thing, like, way back in the day, we weren't, like, getting drunk. Like, that just, you know, you didn't have the resources, really, to do that very often. So permaculture is the lens through which education can become ethical, regenerative, service-based, entrepreneurial, intrinsically rewarding. I know it's a mouthful. But basically, when I started bringing in permaculture, those three lenses, and permaculture really is just those three ideas. Taking care of people, taking care of the earth, and caring for the future. When I brought that in, it suddenly like straightened everything out for me. It straightened me out in a lot of ways, too. Because I no longer felt like conflicted. So when they asked me questions that would like be like somewhat political, if you didn't know any other answer, I got to do something completely off the wall. And they'd be like, wait, what? And they'd be like, yeah, and then you could just grow that, and you could just put those things up there, and then you wouldn't even have that problem with that fish. And they'd be like, whoa. And then they go home and tell their parents who are totally just in the political, like, that's their team, this is my team. And then the parents are like coming in the next day and they're like, what is this all about? And you tell them it's non-political and they're like, whoa. And they're thinking for the first time in like, what, how many years about this in this region of their brain? I'm not saying they don't think, but I'm just saying that region of their brain that was politicized, it just injected like common sense and reasoning for a moment. And they're like, well, let's go talk to this teacher. You know, and it changed everything for me. And ever since then, I've been liberated from a lot of the junk. Because, I mean, how many people have gone to a high school where the teachers talk bad about the other teachers or subjects? Yup. They do. They do today. So maybe they didn't back then. Maybe they had more respect back then. That'd be awesome. But the reality is they're all linked. All the disciplines are linked. And as an educator, this was really fundamental for me to, like, feel and realize and express to other educators. At the end of my teaching, I retired from public ed, but at the end of it, I started teaching teachers at conferences and stuff. And that's actually what segued into me doing this with permaculture. I actually started doing permaculture at all the teaching conferences. And it was my way of fixing all the problems they deal with. Like, I didn't ever use homework. If it's real learning, do you need to practice it on a sheet of paper that night? Absolutely not. You learn to cut a tree down, you go home and draw pictures of it and go, well, I'm practicing. It's going to get good. No. And so it's authentic learning moments. If they're tied to who you are, you don't forget. Because it's valuable, it's who you are, and it's what you're going to do. You know what I mean? And so that's how I always talk. And so I created this series with that in mind. And these are just excerpts from my book. We talk about paddock shifting, and you guys know Joel Saladin. He does that, but it's holistic managed paddock shifting, right? And so we talk about microclimates and nitrogen fixers. This is my new book. This is the high school textbook. Thanks. We're almost done. It's 444 pages long right now. And it's a full high school year of curriculum. And it's basically, you know, all those developments we talked about since Bill Mollison came out with Permaculture, a designer's manual? I'm trying to include all that, but include the people who are actually doing the research and the people who are actually businesses that are doing it. So like Curtis Stone read over his section and then told me like, oh no, that's wrong. So I had it 6 acres and not 6 plots. And so I thought, you can't earn $100,000 on a third of an acre. And that's literally what he did. And that entire time I thought it was 6 plots and his home plot's a third acre. That's how I wrote it.
Is your book gonna be available to the public?
Yes, yes. So I tend to write really openly. So my book, my eighth grade book is written so that eighth graders alone can use it without a teacher. So I'm a homeschool parent, right? And so what I didn't realize is that's actually Harry Potter. So that's the reading level that we all find is so easy that we can just go, yep, I'll be finishing this today and it's good. You know what I mean? It's enjoyable to read at eighth grade reading level. It's just so easy. So I wrote it that way and suddenly everyone started buying me. I was like, wow, you're not in middle school. And I like was like really quiet and just was like, right, this is weird. But I realized it was the New York Times reading level, right? And so the high school is much more advanced and it's huge. And it's taking all these different edges together, like architecture, like alternative energy, like mycology, all this new research and marrying it in. And I mean I'm working with Elaine Ingham, I'm working with a huge list of people, and it's really exciting because I'm continuously the student, but I'm also the teacher for my age group, and they're all like collegiate, so it's like I get to go back to master's school or, you know, and work more on those kinds of things, and it's been really, really phenomenal. So, you have a question? The Permaculture Student 1 is on sale in Findlay Hall. And you can get online at thepermaculturestudent.com. It's digital too, so it's really cheap for digital, and you can just download it instantly. But that's like basically like a condensed PDC with all the information that you would get at a PDC, and it takes you step by step through what you would do to a house or a home site with a PDC's information, and so. From there, because that's like where permaculture has led us to the PDC level. I've got 3 minutes. From there, I've done this whole thing where I've taken all this new information and research, like Peter McCoy, Curtis Stone, Mark Shepard, Grant Schultz. I mean, there's so many people. Like, you guys know Bhutan is carbon negative? Yeah, crazy. There's lots of things that, you know, not everyone knows about yet that I've alluded to. So I've got only a couple minutes left. So we're gonna have plant breeding in it. We have a full fungi chapter instead of being part of the soil chapter. Do you guys know Wangari Maathai? The Greenbelt movement was started by a woman who was educated in America, who was born in Kenya, who returned and saw the hunger. She returned and was like, oh my word, what is going on here? And she was the first PhD, to the woman in East Africa to have a PhD. She came back and basically her opinion changed the government and eventually had the government leader step down. And her story, she's a Nobel Peace Prize winner. It's really incredible, but it's all holistic, basically permaculture. She's not using those words, but it is. And so that's why she's in there. And then like, there's so much of this stuff that's happening. Joseph Simcox, he's been here in years past. He's looking for plants that are horticultural solutions to all these problems we're having. It's like, oh yeah, we don't have water here. Why are you growing those plants? Wangari Maathai. It's M-A-A-T-H-A-I. So, the nitrogen cycle, I've only got a minute left. Do you guys know that the nitrogen cycle in most high school textbooks, well, all high school textbooks, are wrong? And I spent 2 weeks talking to Elaine to figure out what actually is correct visually. So, restorative circles. Do you guys know what nonviolent communication is? I think most kids should know what that is. We should understand what restorative circles are, restorative justice, these sorts of things. So I include social principles in the permaculture book that I'm writing. which, you know, you mostly find gardening techniques. But it's everything. Why would we stop at the garden, right? This is about a food forest in Morocco. This is a book I'm writing with a Disney animator. This is a food forest that's 3,000 years old in the middle of the desert. It's amazing. And we're gonna make a children's story about it, so, and it's historical fiction, so that's allowed in school, right? Because it's history, right? It's based in a natural geographical location. So this, we're gonna get into school. We're gonna have third and fourth graders reading this and learning about how food forests can last thousands of years. This is a picture from it. She's an amazing artist, and she, if your kids watch Nickelodeon, they've seen her art. This is the recent book I just came out with. It's only in digital form. In a couple months, it'll be physical form. And it's about making school gardens with permaculture. And it's super fun. It's designed for kids to be read to by their teachers and also be actually accurate to scale up to actually be used by the teachers, which is actually something that rarely happens. You look at information from kindergarten, you're like, what is this? That is not a really good picture because that will confuse them later on. You know, so cross-curricular unit examples. This is from me working with the international school down in LA, you know, the six locations, the French schools, the international baccalaureate French schools down there. They're changing their program so that the core of their program is permaculture. And then we're gonna make a database of lesson plans that all the international baccalaureate schools can use all over the world that are permaculture based, so that their core, which is their CASS, their CAS core, is designed around being ethical to people and the planet and the future. So we can live regeneratively, we can learn and teach regenerative skills. So let's go do it. Let's go live local and get off the grid.